It was just the most massive thing I've ever seen. To tell you the honest truth, I thought, well, we're the only ones left on this planet. Something's happened. We've missed something here.
The fear that went in me when I seen it was just like the feeling. I'd say it was fear, but I've never felt that feeling before in my entire life.
It's a weird feeling, like you can't explain it when you don't know. You feel like you're being followed, but you don't know what it is.
We had two to our right, another one in front of us, another one to the left, and another one just across the road, shaking the daylight out of the tree. All we get is a big red eye.
I remember waking up and looking at the end of the bed, and there was a figure there, almost insect-like, and then I blacked out.
Welcome to the show, everyone. My name is Cade Moyer, and you are listening to the Believe Paranormal and UFO Podcast. If you have had an encounter and would like to share it, please get in touch with me. My email address is believepod@gmail.com. If you enjoy the podcast, be sure to leave us a rating or review wherever you listen and head on over to our website, believepod.com, and consider becoming a member to get bonus episodes and video content. Tonight I'm joined by Shay, and Shay is joining us all the way from Austin, Texas, and she sent me an absolute ripper of an email. It's not every day that we get someone who has had basically a childhood growing up right next to Wright-Patterson Air Base, which is very well known for basically being the Roswell crash retrieval site. So Shay, welcome to the podcast.
Oh, thanks, Kate. Thanks for having me.
It is super cool to have you on because, like I said, this is that's like the holy grail for UFO activity, and you got to grow up basically right next door to it. So, and that's not even.
Right, I didn't quite know the history of it, but yes, I definitely. It was interesting growing up there,
and that's really the tip of the iceberg of I guess the craziness and the unusual aspects of your life, because I guess growing up next to that, there would have been a lot of Chinese whispers kind of going on in the city of, hey, is there an alien on this base? Is there not? did you yeah. Find that?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And long before I learned about the Area 51 crash and I'm going to use air quotes, the rumors that the wreckage was brought there. Growing up in elementary school, and actually I spoke with my mother even, and my mother grew up in the town just over, also very next. So Wright-Patterson Air Force Base is very large. It goes from, it's actually two towns. It's one of the larger in the country. So my mom grew up with these rumors as well. So as in elementary, I would hear from kids, and it was always a lot of the kids I went to high school, or excuse me, elementary and high school with, had parents in the Air Force. So everybody had a story of, oh, my grandfather saw the frozen alien on the Air Force base. And, it was very commonly discussed and known that there was an alien on that Air Force base. And I remember hearing, oh, it's in Bunker B, or something like that. And it was just common, and you couldn't find anyone that hadn't heard that. I mean, and I did. I always kind of, as a child, was like, oh, that's, oh, that's scary, as you do. It's kind of a, the crybaby bridge. Every city's got one. But growing up, I actually, I was like, oh, there actually might have been one. or two. I actually heard two growing up. There was two of them. But then later, it narrowed down that one had been destroyed in the crash, and the other one lived. And that was the rumor as a child. So as an adult, can imagine the eye-opening moment you'd have when you're like, they took wreckage from a UFO crash to the Air Force base I grew up next to, and incidentally I grew up with these rumors. And that's not, I live next to an Air Force base here now in Texas, and I have not heard a rumor of an alien being on that one. So
it's still early. It's still early. You never know.
That's right. I actually asked people. I remember telling someone, a friend of mine who grew up here, I was like, did you ever grow up with any, do they think there's anything on that? And she had no idea what I was talking about. I'm like, oh, God, I grew up with these rumors about an alien on this base. And turns out that rumor has been there since my mother was in school. So, you know, it may not be a rumor, given the date of Area 51's, you know, the wreckage being brought there.
It's a rather exciting way to kind of grow up through a childhood, to have such a, I guess, a monumental part of UFO history be just part of your folklore, like your town's kind of boogeyman story. But talking about a perfect segue, which that one was, you have had an encounter with a boogeyman when you were rather young.
Yes. Yeah, that's what I called him. And I had no other name. So this would have happened before I was 5 years old. And the reason that I know that is my parents, I had young parents. So we lived in an apartment. And I guess it was like a duplex, which I don't know if y'all have them over there, but they're basically, it's a long house that has been constructed into two separate family homes. So then it becomes an apartment duplex. And I lived in one of those. And what's odd about it is the human memory, your formative years, they say, you know, happens, you know, 5 years and younger, which is, you know, interesting because I shouldn't have such vivid memories of this place. And I do. I've actually sketched out exactly what it looked like. And this would have been pre 5 years old for my mother to see, you know, and it kind of creeped her out. I knew exactly where the couch was, where the TV was. And I think the reason that place is burned in my memory is because I had a younger sister who came when I was 3.5 years old. And I'd say prior to that, because I do remember the first sighting being before the crib was in there and in my room. And I used to see these entities, and I called them boogeymen. I had no other word for them. And they stood about, and this is from the perspective of an adult, I would say they were about my height. So they maybe would have been 3 feet tall, you know, two to three feet tall. And they were, the skin was, I have no other way to describe it. Their skin was gray. Although they don't match the descriptive of grays that people have encountered. And they had these very large mouths. And I actually drew them out one time. And they had these very large mouths. And what they would do, and they started by coming to my window at night. So when I would be laying in bed, if I looked directly up there, you know, I could see the window. And I used to see them come to the window. And they would scare me. I remember screaming. I mean, I can't imagine what my mother was going through, because I would yell, the boogeyman, boogeyman. Now, where I got the word boogeyman also was another thing. My mother's like, I don't know why you were calling him that. But I was, you know. And so what they would do, they started by coming outside of the house. But what started happening is I started seeing indoors and inside the house. And they would smile. And they would have these big, big mouths with these very large, sharp teeth. And I can still see them. And that's kind of the weird thing about it. They would just chill me to the bone. I would scream hysterically and point at nothing. My mom would say all this all the time. But I can remember them. And I remember a time, probably the most vivid time of seeing them. And I might have been four, maybe three. And so my mother, now this is back in the 80s, so my mom was out in our parking lot, and she's still way out in the sun, you know, as people used to do to get a suntan. And I went out the back door, and you know, I was talking with her, probably whining to her about something, you know. And she's like, oh, you know, would you go inside and get me a glass of tea? My mom used to make this sun tea and all the time. And so I was like, okay, yeah. And I remember going into the kitchen, which there was just a screen door that separated the kitchen from my mom, you know, just on the other side of it, laying out in the sun about a few feet from the door. And I went in and I poured the tea. And I remember, so we had these cookies, like up in the cabinet, and I could push the chair up to the ledge of the counter and climb onto the counter and open the top cabinets to get these cookies. And I thought I was going to be slick and do that. And so I climbed this this counter and I opened the cabinet to grab a cookie. And I heard them behind me. And I remember I used to hear something, but I can't recall what the sound was. I would just hear something when they were nearby. And I turned around and there were three of them. And that was the other thing that started happening. So they started coming in threes, which was a little just notable. And what they would do is when I turn and look upon them, they smile at you. Okay. Now that, and I know this sounds crazy, but they do. Their smiles are not pleasant, though. They're very scary. And I remember yelling at them to get away from me. And my mom coming, I mean, I was frozen on this counter with, you know, a little Debbie's in my hand, screaming at nothing, you know, into an adult's mind to get away from me, to go. And my mom comes running in and, you know, and I'm like, I'm trying to get down off the counter, you know, into the chair, and I'm a little child. And she's like, oh, you know. And I don't really recall much after that. I just, you know, as far as what happened, but I remember that's how I remember seeing them that one time and screaming at them. And my mom was like, you used to scream and get upset. And then this one time I was screaming angrily for them to get away. And I remember telling my mom about a girl, about someone named Lydia. Now, this is interesting. Lydia, which was not a common name in that time. It was after the movie Beetlejuice released, but that would have been many years later. there was and I cannot remember what Lydia looks like. I have no recollection of what she looks like. But my mother said I started talking to someone named Lydia. And I told her that Lydia told me to yell at these things to get away from me, and they had to. And so I find it interesting. So then my mom would say, she said that Lydia followed me everywhere and that I would be in my room. I'd be playing with Lydia, and she could tell, you know, that I was playing with Lydia because I would be in this hot, you know, and laughing and giggling versus being terrified and screaming. So Lydia, I believe, was my protector from these things. And incidentally, my niece, my brother's daughter's name is Lydia, which is just wild. But I describe my mother to her as having long, dark hair and green eyes. And but I have no clue what she looks like. But I can remember these boogeymen. And they kept coming, and I would keep yelling at them to get away. But at first, I would just scream hysterically and run and hide. And they were there the entire time until the day I moved. And the day that I moved, I think, was actually the biggest attack that they did on me. And I remember this vividly because my grandmother, my mom's mother, came to help us move. And I think she was just watching me and my little sister while my parents moved into the new house. And I started seeing them everywhere. And I remember in the house the day of. And they were everywhere I turned. And I remember screaming and yelling, you know, and going to my grandmother's car and, you know, and just hiding in there. And she came out. And I think I remember the only thing I remember my mom saying to my grandmother was like, I think she's tired. But what's crazy is I wasn't tired at all. These things were just tormenting me because I was leaving. And I remember being in my grandmother's car. This is the most vivid memory I have of that day. I remember sitting in my grandmother's car because I was too afraid to go back into the house because I kept seeing them in the old house. And I felt calm, but then I started feeling like bugs were all over me. And I started thinking I was seeing bugs all over me. Now that's, but they weren't, you know. And so I started brushing myself off, you know, and kind of hysterically and jumping. I jumped out of the car again, you know, mind you, it's parked. She was in talking to my mother, but, you know, so I was just sitting and waiting in the running car. But I jumped out, and I remember shaking myself off and taking my shoes off and, like, telling my parents that there were bugs on me. And they're like, there's no bugs on you. There's no bug. And I was like, I need to take a shower or give me a shower, like, because I could see them. But I remember my grandmother just being like, what is, I mean, she was like, what is happening? Now, my mom's kind of become a little bit more accustomed to this behavior of me kind of freaking out, you know? And I just remember being like, I need a shower. Because I was convinced there were bugs everywhere, although I could see them. But there weren't. There were no bugs on me. It was just, you know, this weird attack that happened from these things. But I saw them constantly, all the time. And it absolutely terrified me.
It genuinely sounds like these things were just there to torment you.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I didn't know what they were. I didn't, you know, growing up, up until I was about 19, did I find out what they possibly could have been. I just thought the house was haunted, you know, like as in my childhood, because I didn't see anything in the new home that I grew up in. It was literally, it stopped at that place. And I was 19. I was actually getting a tattoo in Seattle, Washington. And I was talking to the tattoo artist, and she was telling me that she, and I believed her, she was telling me she had some psychic abilities. And she said, oh, and it started, I said something to her like, well, when did it start, you know, or how did you know, or whatever. She goes, and she stopped tattooing and took her gloves off. And she goes, when I started seeing these things when I was, when I was a kid. And she flips her sketchbook open. You can imagine how, where I'm going with this and how it made me feel. So she flips her, you know, she's flipping through her sketchbook, and she's like, I started seeing these things when I was a kid. She opens her sketchbook, and sure enough, man, she had a drawing of what I used to call the boogeymen. She had a drawing of three of them. Now, she was an artist, so they were very, very vivid. And she could see I lost color in my face for a bit. And she goes, oh God. She goes, let's take a break. Let's go get some air. I was like, yeah. Because, I wanted to ask her about him, but I literally froze when I saw him. I hadn't seen him, you know, I kind of put them out of my mind for the most part at that point.
That would have been such a head spin movement.
Oh, my God. Yeah. I don't even have words for what that felt like. That was insane. It was absolutely insane. And I thought I was hallucinating. It's like, there is no way this woman just showed me a picture of the thing. I mean, it was almost exact. I mean, it took me right back to that moment. And, but it made me very curious. Why does she know about them? What are they? Like, maybe she knows more. And, because these things tormented me. And she told me that, we went outside to get a breath of fresh air because I wasn't breathing. I turned green. I was like, oh my God. And she's like, I said, what are those? I said, and she goes, and she, again, saying that she had a psychic ability, she said to me, she was like, you saw those, didn't you? And I was like, yeah, I did. And I was like, what are they? Like, what is it? And she said that she looked into it, and she was a bit older than I was. She looked into it, and it turned out that these, they had a name, and I, for the life of me, can't remember. But they were an entity, a type of entity that specifically attacked children with psychic abilities.
Oh, wow.
She said, yeah. She said she believed that it was a way to sort of scare it out of them. Because I turned it off. Anything that could be seen that was not real in my mind, I did not want to see. I turned it off. If there was something, a switch to hit, I hit it, you know? And because they terrified me. And that's what most experiences in childhood with any, you know, most encounters of any kind, they tend to terrify them. You know, these were tormenting. They kept coming back, and their only goal was to scare. They had an element of surprise. They liked to peek around corners and pop out of nowhere with these big, big smiles. And that's probably the most disturbing thing. And she said the same thing. She goes, yeah, they'll smile, and they have very sharp, big mouth, very, very sharp teeth with big mouths. And she goes, oh yeah, they go after kids with psychic abilities. And it blew my mind. I'll see that. It definitely blew my mind. So apparently it is not, what I was seeing has been seen by other people. And, it definitely blew my mind. It definitely blew my mind seeing it at 19 by another person. And, yeah.
it would have been a moment where it kind of just solidified everything else that you've ever experienced, I imagine.
Well, I mean, I think that may have been the worst or best part of it was I had convinced myself it was just I had an overactive imagination. That's what I was told, you know. I was ADHD as a child, which is not uncommon for people with abilities to have some sort of neurodiversity. So it wasn't completely out of the realm that I would have an overactive imagination, imaginary friends, or maybe even see things that weren't there. And so I kind of accepted that that's what it was. As scary as it was, I accepted that I just had an overactive imagination, you know? And that's what I was being told, you know? I mean, and that's, you know, as parents would do. You know, you're not, I can't imagine parents are to, you know, a 3-4-year-old going, oh, yeah, you're seeing entity, all right, you know? They're going to say, it's your imagination, you know? So just to keep you from being upset, you know? And so I find it interesting that, you know, that she was able to validate that. Interesting is not the word. It was kind of earth-shattering. This was not just my overactive imagination, because other people see these things. They have a name. They have a specific job that they do, essentially. And so it made me rethink a lot of things. Because that would not have, by any stretch of the word, that would not have been the last time I encountered something that wasn't, the science can't really explain, modern science can't really explain. So it was very validating. It was also quite frightening to accept that that wasn't in my head.
What was your parents' reaction about all of this? Because I could imagine they would be like, oh, Shay's got a very active imagination, but that would wear thin after a while.
Yeah.
If you're constantly being tormented by these things, did they ever come out with, like, when you were older, especially with a, yeah, look, we thought something weird was going on, or was it just never really addressed? And now a quick word from our sponsor. Also, are you wanting more content? Why not become a Believe Plus member? You'll get access to exclusive podcasts and episodes that aren't available to the public. Not only that, you'll also get our regular feed without any ads. Head to believepod.com/plus to sign up today for just $5 a month.
So my mother did actually admit, you know, later, you know, when I did start talking about it again, because I didn't speak of it for many years, you know, and I think in the moment, when I was very young, and they were young parents. So my mother had me at 18, my dad was 20. So we're talking about, you know, a 23-year-old and a 21-year-old, you know, and I was their first child. So, you know, I think a lot of it was they were trying to navigate it in a healthy way. I will give them that. I don't, you know, but I also think that while it was happening, I think, so my father was just trying to get me to be independent. Because he's a little bit more, I guess, I don't know the word. I would say practical-minded, but I think we're practical-minded too. But, you know, he was a little bit more black and white when it came to that sort of thing. So he just thought, you know, I was having bad dreams, or I was, you know, overactive imagination. So his goal was just to get me independent and keep me sleeping in my own bed and stuff like that. My mom, you know, was very nurturing throughout it. But, you know, I do think she just didn't quite understand, you know, and I do think that it definitely wore on their patience. And but my mother was always very I don't ever remember you know, my mom ever being cruel about it, or saying or acting in a way that seemed very frustrated. And I would find out later that she herself didn't see any of those things, but she did not like that apartment. She says she always felt a very thick energy there, a very unsettled energy that, you know, so I think that there was a part of her that actually, so I have a funny story about it. I think there was a part of her that nervously believed that there was something there because she could feel something. So my mom has a touch of being clairvoyancy as well, but she wasn't seeing it. She could feel, you know, and, but one time, I guess, okay, so this is a little bit funny, but one time she was listening in on me while I was playing in my room. And I had this red rotary play phone. It was an old phone, and it wasn't hooked into the wall. And I was talking, apparently, to Lydia on the phone, and my mother was listening in, and she could hear me laughing, and I was by myself. So she's like, oh, my, okay. She put, you know, listening in. Yeah, the door cracked a little. She said I was having a conversation where it very much seemed like I was answering someone, and, you know, she's not like kids. I wasn't making up a voice. And it creeped her out so much that she, like, opened the door and asked me who I was talking to on the phone. Now, this is the phone that's not plugged in. And I told her Lydia. And she told me, she goes, I, like, told you to go play outside, or, you know, go to your friend's house. I had a friend across the, you know, just down the next door. You know, go play next door or whatever. And I was like, okay. And I left. And my mom said she, like, nervously picked up the phone and put it to her ear and said hello. Like, you know. She was like, I did actually think somebody might have been on that phone because you were, like, talking to someone and answering someone, like, you know, in a one-sided conversation, you know, like, where you're, because I felt like I was hearing one side of the conversation. And she told me that in adulthood. She goes, I felt so silly picking up this old phone that was not plugged into the wall and saying hello into it to see if anyone was in. She goes, but it, I mean, she was like, there was times where she really, it did creep her out. So when we did talk about it in adult, I gave her the whole story, you know, she wasn't surprised, not one bit, you know, that this was something I knew was not just in my imagination. Because then she started telling me, you know, of times that I creeped her out so much, she started questioning herself, you know, like things that children just shouldn't do or be able to do or know, you know. So the red phone. So yeah, I mean, they were as supportive as they could have been, you know, I think, given the circumstance that their child's running and screaming and pointing at windows and saying boogeymen are out there, you know, every night, you know, as you do. But yeah, it stayed that way all the way up until I was about 5 years old when we moved into the house that I grew up in, which was in the same town near Dayton, Ohio. And then I actually didn't see anything in that house. I only saw one thing one time, and it was a very unique experience. If you're interested, this one actually, I didn't know what this was, but I think I do now. It wasn't one of the boogeymen, but it wasn't a human either. So if you want me to tell you about that,
yeah,
that brief
absolutely.
One I had. Okay. Okay. So this would have been, I would imagine, a handful of months. It's still pretty new because I was still kind of on guard. So when I moved into the new house, I didn't, you know, I didn't think that it would stop. You know, I imagined they would just follow. So I was kind of on guard of that. Well, after a handful of months, they didn't. I didn't see them anymore, and I felt safe. So my dad was always very, like, you know, go to bed at 9 o'clock when I was at 8, you know, you sleep in your own bed. It was all about independence, which I think was the right move. You know, you can't be coddled for too long. But incidentally, though, a handful of months later, I remember, so we used to have a clock in our living room, and when it was noon, or, like, you know, 12 and 3, 6 and 9, it would make a little, like, bong noise, you know. And I always knew that because at 9 o'clock we had to go to bed. And that was, like, you know, my dad would be, it was like 8:59. And I'd be like, you know, as a kid, you know, little kid, like, it hasn't bonged yet, which they'd always laugh at. It hasn't bonged yet. You know, the door, the clock. But so anyway, I was out on the couch, and I wasn't really allowed to be sleeping on the couch. You know, like, we were supposed to be in our bed, you know, can't be up and about. And I woke up to that bong, you know, and it was 3 a.m. And that's what woke me up. So I woke up and I was out on the couch in my living room, which I did not fall asleep there. And I'm 100%. And if I had, my father would have moved me to my bed. Cause there was, you know, they just, you know, just how it is, you know, they didn't want us getting into things and whatnot. And so I woke up and, I looked around, I was very confused. So I was like, why am I on the couch? And I'm looking around. So again, I'm maybe 5 years old. I'm like, why am I on the couch? And I'm, like, looking, and I look at the clock, and I'm like, you know, I'm not even sure I could tell time, you know, I'm just like, it's the middle of the night. I knew that, you know? So I'm like, oh my God. And And where I was laying, you would have seen the doorway to the kitchen. And I was just kind of laying there, confused on how and why I was in the living room in the middle of the night. And I saw this figure come, and he peeked his head around the corner, and he was like a glowing white. I have no other way to put it. He had kind of a block. I keep saying he, but, you know, it's, I saw it was a male. I don't know. Kind of a block head, and big round eyes. But he was not like the other ones. He had a smaller mouth, and he peeked his head out. And I was staring at him for a second. Now, I've been awake for a minute because I've been confused, you know, why I'm in the living room. And he waved at me. And I just kind of looked. And instantly, I mean, as soon as the hand went up to wave, it was almost like a friendly gesture. I started getting scared. I thought it was the boogie. You know, I thought they were back. And but I felt it, now this was the first, I would say, like, communication I had, and I remember this very distinctly. Like, I remember feeling or hearing it, but it didn't speak. Say, it's okay, I'm not going to hurt you. Now I remember that, like, 100%, because I started screaming, and I remember it saying that. And when I started screaming, you know, it disappeared into a little, kind of like I'd say a little static ball. You know, it just like vanished into like a little static ball, but it put its hand out to almost say, like, you're okay. Like, you know, it's okay. But it still scared me, and I still screamed in its face. And I remember it almost changed its facial expression to a fear, you know, like, oh, you know, I'm sorry, you know, and then it disappeared. And it was the only time I ever saw that in that particular house. I never saw anything there. And that was the one thing. And it was another entity, but it was saying, it literally said, it's okay, I'm not going to hurt you. But I screamed anyway. I was too traumatized from the other things. But I remember, you know, I thought on that for a long time, like, wow, that, what was that? You know, and because it didn't look like the other ones. This is quite fascinating. I mean, to look back on, because that was it. And then I never saw anything in that particular house again, you know?
Do you scare him off?
What's that? Yeah, I know. I'm in the feeling I got, in the feeling I've had when I remember him, is that he was friendly. He was almost saying, like, you're safe now, you're okay, you know. But it's still, you know, I still screamed, you know, and I was still just too. I think it was trying to say it's okay, but you know, I just it startled me way too much, and it left. You know, when I screamed, unlike the other entities that would not leave when I would just scream, I had to tell them to get away. So it was, and that was the only thing I saw in that house, in that particular house that I grew up in.
Wow. It would have been such a scary thing not to know if these things are going to follow you to the new place, because I know you're rather young when you moved, but geez, I still think it would have had a bit of an impact on you to just be tormented over and over and over again, and to know that you're going to move, like, that's the escape, and not knowing if that's going to work or not, that would have been terrible.
Yeah, it absolutely was. I was on guard, you know, as a child for a fair amount of time. It was, since we moved in there, you know, because I didn't know. You know, I guess in my child mind, I didn't know if these things could be attached to a house. If they were attached to me, I knew that I saw them all the time, and they attacked me only, and I was the only one that could see them, which is also in and of itself a little frustrating, because something that vile and scary as a child, and no one else can see it but you. You're pointing at nothing, you know? And so there's this feeling of, like, and I'm like, why can't you guys see this? It's right there, like, you know. Because they became more brazen to go in front of my parents, you know, but my parents couldn't see them. And I think that, you know, it did make me very, very scared that I was always going to see them. But I was, you know, for whatever reason, they stayed in that house, and I didn't see them again. And I didn't think on them, you know, too much. I could remember them, but I didn't think on them too much until that experience, you know, where I met the other woman who had seen them. And then, you know, even then I didn't want to think of myself as psychic or, you know, having been special. I still found it easier to think, well, you know, I tried to think that these were just in my imagination, but, you know, then it was like, okay, maybe a little validating other people see him, you know. Maybe I wasn't a crazy child after all. But, you know, I don't know which is worse, thinking that it was all in your head or thinking that it was definitely not. So.
Yeah, that these things happen. Like, that's it's a terrifying thought to go, oh, was this just a thing I made up, or was this a genuine horror story that I lived?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that as a child, you know, you look for parents and adults for guidance, and I was being told this was in my head, so, you know, it was in my head. And you know, I think that was easier to accept. Children have, you know, more vivid imaginations, and, you know, I mean, that would have been easier, I believe.
Yeah.
But it was very mind-blowing to find out later that this was not an uncommon thing. So that's one reason I wanted to share this with you on the show is I've actually spoken to a few people since, you know, since this ability of mine has evolved in the last handful of years. And I found that I would say very common. They're very common for people to have seen with any type of abilities when they were young. And in particular, again, I want to revisit a lot of people that I know, you know, near back home. I know like probably three people who have some like sensitive, who are at least sensitive, and they saw something similar. All three, and they presented a little different with them, but they saw something similar as a child that was not human, you know, and would terrify them. And what, from what I was told by the woman, the tattoo artist who showed him to me, she said that, I found this study. She told me about it. She found this study. I'll tell you real quick of how these were discovered. And it turned out she had told me about it, you know, when I was there. It turned out it was a psychiatrist years ago whose child had was seeing these things and he couldn't explain it and yada yada, and they did a study where they took I think it was like 100 children who were seeing things and kept them separate and had them draw what they were seeing, and I want to say it was like something crazy like 90% of them drew the same thing.
Wow.
Yeah, and this was back before the internet was all over. She had a book about it. And I remember reading on it and being like, oh my God. And then it was like, you know, he was eventually, I guess, ostracized from the psychiatric community because, you know, when you're like, hey guys, I know we're here to study the mind, but, you know, entities, they tend to boot you out. So he was ostracized for conducting, I guess, this study to understand his own child more. But yeah, they kept them all separate and had them draw out what they were seeing, and they were all seeing, about 90% of them were drawing the same or very similar things. And it's all with the mouth, I guess, and the teeth, you know, that was the thing, is that the big smile just terrifies children. It would terrify an adult, but it terrifies children.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, Shay, I know that those encounters are really kind of the bread and butter kind of encounters of your life. But they're not the only encounters that you've had, because you've had something happen to you rather recently that you wanted to talk about as well.
Yeah, so I've had quite a few things. So I'll step back just once to one summer. I actually want to go into one thing that happened in a summer I spent with my grandmother when I was 8. And this might be the most terrifying experience with otherworldly things I've ever had to date. if you want to hear about that one, it would be later. So this would have been, I guess, about 3 to 4 years after we moved. And so I've had 3 to 4 years of seeing nothing except for the one thing that was trying to tell me it was okay. So life kind of returned to a normal childhood, so to speak, until I went to my grandmother's for the summer in Tennessee. And I'd love to tell you about that one, because that one's probably my strongest, scariest encounter.
I am definitely keen for that. We've got about 20-ish minutes. We can definitely fit that in.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So my grandmother is, this is my dad's mother. She moved, they're from Tennessee. She moved back to Tennessee when I was about three. So when I was going through all this stuff, And so I didn't get to see her a lot. So when my younger brother was being born, my grandmother, my dad's mom, agreed to take me and my sister it was supposed to be 2 weeks. We ended up being there the whole summer, while my mom had my little brother and her and my dad got, into the swing of a newborn. And we were like just beaming, because we never got to see my grandma. And, grandma's always like, spoil you and, let you do whatever. And so we went to Tennessee to stay there. And my grandmother lived in kind of one of those, it's kind of a modular, like a trailer home for, retirees and stuff, as you do. And so the first encounter I had in this home, I was there, we were having a great time, and it started, so I would have been 9 years old, I think, so that would have made my sister like maybe six, yeah. And it started by me waking up. So I was sleeping on the couch in the living room, my sister was sleeping on the love seat, and there was a coffee table in between us. And I woke up and I saw my younger sister sitting at the coffee table. I get chills just telling this, with her hands folded on the coffee table, and she was looking up at the ceiling. It was kind of like she was praying, but she was looking up at the sky, smiling. And she was very still. And I woke up and there was kind of a light shining on her, like a moonlight almost, it felt like coming in from the window. And she was not transparent. It was her, And I was like, what are you doing? And I said that to her. I was like, what are you doing? Go back to bed. Get back to bed. I was like confused. Like, why are you up? Go back to, lay back down. And it didn't move. And I was like, Tara, get up, go to bed. What are you doing? I was so confused. And I'm saying this to her, but she's not looking. I mean, it was very odd. She was not looking at me or acknowledging me. So I looked just up a little bit where the love seat was, which would have been like kind of up against the wall where my head was. And there my sister was, my actual sister, sleeping. Yeah. And so I looked back at the coffee table, which is just, 2 feet away. And it was still there. And so I'm looking back and forth to see my actual sister and something that looks just like my sister smiling blankly at the ceiling. And I'm, a 6-year-old looking up and with her hands folded. And I mean, as soon as I kind of collected what was happening, and mind you, in my head, I'm thinking somehow she's doing this, it's a trick. I don't understand it, so I bolt screaming to my grandmother's room. I pound on the door. I wake her up and she comes out. She's like, what's going on? And I'm like trying to tell her. I'm like, Tara was at the coffee table, but it wasn't her. And I mean, I'm not making any sense. I'm like, no, Tara, because then my grandma's up like, are you getting out of bed, Tara? And I'm like, no, she was in bed. She's in bed. But she was also at the coffee. I couldn't explain it. I remember just being like, something that looked like Tara was at the coffee table. Like, I had no other way of explaining it. And I made my grandmother sleep. Like, well, I didn't make her, but, she chose to sleep in the living room with me. And I remember the whole night, she was down on the floor just by the, laying down until I went back to sleep by the couch. And I just kept my hand down on her so that I could tell she was there, because it absolutely terrified me. And throughout that summer, I loved being there. I loved spending time, but it kept happening. And it was odd because it was always surrounding my sister. It would mimic her, and I would see her when it wasn't her. Like, I remember I went into my grandmother's house to grab a pop, and I saw my sister in the hall, but it didn't quite look like her. So that was what it would do. And I was like confused. And I was like, what are you doing? And then I like was walking, you know, I was like, what are you doing? And I kind of looked, staring at me funny, you know, I'm like, what are you doing? And I walked back out of the, you know, the house just because I'm like weirdo. And then I cut turn around the corner and then my actual sister is outside. And I was like, how did you do that? How did you get, you were just inside. How did you do that? And they were confused the whole time. Cause I'm like, what is happening? Like, I just saw Tara inside. I just saw her inside. She was in the hall staring at me. And then of course I'm like, oh my God, it didn't quite look like her, you know? And then there were times when I would be looking at my sister or my sister would be talking and it would start to change her face. And now that was probably the most disturbing thing. It would distort it. Or at least make me think that it was distorted. That went the whole time, and it was really beyond terrifying. I would call my mother like, I want to come home, I want to come home. But then, you know, again, I'm also being told it's my imagination, and you know, they're kind of laughing, teasing me because what I'm saying doesn't make sense. You know, my sister. Tara's here. How did she do that? She's playing tricks on me. And it was just whatever this entity was mimicking her. And I mean, it absolutely petrified. I to this day, I just get chills thinking about what that was like. And, you know, but I didn't want to go home necessarily because I loved being around my grandmother. And I knew, right, you know, we were going to be 7 hours away and I wouldn't be able to see her for a very long time when I went home. But then I had a point where I was like, I just, you know, I begged. I want to go home. And that was it. We left, you know. But we kept wanting to stay. And then it was like, you know, it was happening. And then it started happening more and more until I was like, I want to go home. So I would say the first encounter happened about maybe about at the 2 week mark. So I was having a good old time. And then after that 2 week mark, it started becoming more and more frequent. I started seeing her when she wasn't there and it would change her face while I looked at her. It never really harmed me or hurt me physically, but it would impersonate my sister and it would distort her face while I looked at her. And I'm an adult saying this now and I'm like, I was not in my head about that. That definitely happened. and I had a psychic reading once who asked me about it out of nowhere. I hadn't told a soul. Like, I was far too, like, how do you tell that to somebody, you know? And I remember getting a psychic reading, and one of the first things he said was, tell me about your grandmothers. And, you know, I'm like, oh, or what do you mean? You know, playing coy. And he's like, no, tell me about... he goes, you were there for a little while and it's terrified you. Tell me about that. He knew, and I'm like, he was very good. I'm like, how did he know that? I've never told anybody. But he did explain to me what he believed it was, which, you know, I don't know. It was by far the most terrifying thing I'd ever seen, ever had to be a victim to, I guess.
That is terrifying. I have no other way to really put that, because I've heard of mimics before, but to have this thing do it multiple times, that is just absolutely nightmare fuel. And how do you even approach talking about that to someone? That's impossible.
It is. You sound, you know, I mean, even as an adult, when I say it, you know, I have to be careful. I word it because it's like this thing only impersonated my little sister. And for some reason. But as a child, it was almost impossible because, you know, a part of me did not, you know, this is tangible and intangible. In my mind, I'm like, how is she going from the hall to outside? You know, how is she doing that through the one door? You know, that I'm going through. How does she, you know, and a part of me is like, she's playing a trick on me. I mean, but she wasn't. I knew she wasn't. And I think when I realized, I realized that very early on with the first encounter, because I literally saw her sleeping. But, you know, your mind can't, I think that's what makes mimics so terrifying, is your mind cannot wrap your head. It just can't. It just cannot wrap its head around that.
No, not at all. And like, trying to explain that to someone would be impossible.
It is, yeah. It's even difficult to tell you now, you know? It's like, it would just, yeah, it would mimic her, and it would distort her face, you know? Like, but it wasn't, you know, actually distorted. It was just making me think it was distorted, you know? So, and just like a weird, like, her, like I remember one time she was looking down, and her nose appeared to be, like, elongating and pointing, and one thing, and I actually saw this, I read about this in another encounter, which oddly shouldn't have made me feel good, but it did, because I'm like, okay, so this is how I learned about mimics. I didn't know about them, you know, until that was a little bit later, but, you know, and one, there was a woman who had a daughter that it did that with, and it would mimic her. And she said one time when she was like leaving the house, you know, they were leaving the house, she saw her daughter, and it had distorted her daughter's face, or made her think it was. You know, so she said she looked at her daughter, and it was not her daughter. Her daughter had big black eyes and had a big, you know, unrealistic fake smile, which I'm like, yes, it used to do that too. It would, you know, make, you know, which I know sounds insane, but I'm like, it is absolutely what happened. It was, you know, like, just even when I you can hear me, I'm starting to stutter. Like, when I talk about it, it rattled me. And I mean, it's still to this day is probably one of the most terrifying encounters. I'm encountering some ugly things. But yeah, that definitely, that definitely was one of the worst. And, but you know, the whole area that I grew up in Dayton, I mean, and I'll be very curious if there are any listeners, because I'm like, y'all, it's haunted over there. Like, I never, everyone I know, it has an experience, and I don't know what it is about that area. I mean, it just, there are so many haunted houses. I mean, there are so many haunted places there, unlike any place I've ever lived. So, yeah, it's, I always wonder if there's some sort of a connection. You know, I can't help but wonder if there's some sort of a connection with that, why that area is so haunted, and you know, what the, maybe even what the rumors are surrounding it, you know.
Thank you for listening to this episode of the Believe Paranormal and UFO podcast. If you have had an encounter and you would like to share it, please get in touch with me. My email address is believepod@gmail.com. Finally, don't forget to follow us on all our social media outlets, and be sure to join our Discord server to talk to other listeners of the show. You'll find all these links in our show notes. Thank you.